You are a liberal.
I am.
We obviously have different politics, but it doesn't matter. On freedom of speech, we are completely united. Do you feel right now, ideologically, not personally, ideologically, your biggest enemy are conservatives or the left?
Oh, there's no question. A, my biggest enemies are the hard left. B, the hard left poses a far greater danger to the American future than the hard right. I'm not worried about a few dozen people with swastikas who want to replace the Jews, because they're our past. They have no resonance on university campuses today.
Right.
But the hard, hard left anti-Semitism, anti-Christianity, intolerance for speech, it's the future. These are our leaders. When I used to teach 150 students in my first year of criminal law, I'd look around and I'd say, future president, future chief justice, future editorial director of the New York Times, future managing partner of Goldman Sachs, they're our future. And that's why we have to worry much more about what's going on university campuses than in Charlottesville.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Dennis Prager Show. Let me offer a reflection. As I describe myself very often, I am a forest person, more than a tree person. Trees are critical. We need tree people. We need forest people. The tree people are the people who see details and are preoccupied with them, and the forest people are those who see the larger picture and are preoccupied with it. Both are important. I want to make that clear. I'm just explaining into which category I fall. My country, the United States of America, is going mad. I don't know if it's ever happened in American history. There is a madness that rivals, with the exception, obviously, the important exception of fatalities involved, but it rivals in insanity what happened during the craze of the Salem witches. But that, of course, was a very, very brief period. Those involved apologized profusely thereafter, and it faded. The madness in this country, among the well-educated in particular, is reason for deep concern about the viability of the American experiment. That is how crazy. I mean, I'm talking crazy. If you only read, for example, the opinion pieces in the New York Times, you would be subjected to madness. True madness. One of its crackpots, Michelle Goldberg, and they're crackpots. I don't know what else to say. I'm trying to pick the nicest term I can use. How about irresponsible? But irresponsible so understates the case as to be useless. What does she say today? That the NRA is sort of a Russian front? You see, they build lie on lie. First, Russia is the great demon in the world, which it is not. It's simply not. It was when it was the Soviet Union, but it is not since it is the Soviet Union. It is not a benign player in the world, but it is not the demon that it is being made out to be. And it is, incidentally, it was not made out to be a demon under Barack Obama. The whole fraud is in order to undermine the Trump election. That's the only reason for the demonization of Russia. Russia did not appear. I'll tell you this, folks. I'll give $10 and that theoretically it could mount up. I will give $10 to a charity for every single article about how bad Russia and Putin are published during the Obama administration in the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Times. Okay? I mean, so theoretically, we could have here, you know, at least $100 to $1,000 to charity. I don't think I'll be giving $10. During the Obama administration, why didn't it register? Why was there no demonization of Vladimir Putin and the Russia during the Obama administration? Because he didn't register on leftists' radar. It meant nothing to them, Putin. Nothing. They couldn't spell his name. Then Donald Trump was elected, and then they could use Russia as a way of demonizing the election. invalidating the
election. I want to read the definition of treason.
This was nothing short of treasonous. We're hearing a new word, right? He said it was treason, right?
The words like, you know, treason and undermining, you know, our Republican little case R rule of government are being used now.
We have a treasonous president.
The very fact that reasonable people can disagree on whether or not we're talking about treason or high crimes and misdemeanors or what have you, I find genuinely shocking and seriously nauseating.
Joining us now with legal analysis of these absurd claims is the author of the book, The Case Against Impeaching Trump, Harvard Law Professor Alan Dershowitz, Fox News contributor Sarah Carter, Judicial Watch President Tom Fitton. All right, Professor Dershowitz, I'll go to you first. What is treason?
Treason is the only crime defined specifically in the Constitution. It shall consist only in levying war against the United States or in adhering to their enemies, giving them aid and comfort. Obviously, it's wartime. It's what Aaron Burr was accused of doing. It's what people who became Nazis and supported the Nazis and joined right. the Nazi regime were accused of doing. It's not what President Trump did, nor is it what President Franklin Delano Roosevelt did when he went to Yalta and sat down with Stalin and allowed him to control all of Eastern Europe. Many Americans on the right were calling that treasonous or treason, but you can't just throw that term around. It's the only crime specifically defined in the Constitution. I want to make one more point.
Sure.
To compare what President Trump did to the Holocaust or to Kristallnacht is a form of Holocaust denial, because what it suggests is that nothing more happened to the Jews than is happening today in America. It suggests there were no gas chambers, there were no killing fields, there was no plan to kill 6 million Jews. It's a disgraceful comparison.
Well, then,
and
you
it
know,
just demeans the suffering that so many people went through during
without,
the Second World War.
Professor, with
Kristallnacht, 9/11, Pearl Harbor. Why do any of you continue to entertain respect for the left when they say this? Is there anything the left could say or do that would have you rethink a sympathetic view of the left? And the answer is, for many true believers, of course not. The greatest enemy for leftists is not Putin. It's American conservatives. That's whom they hate the most. And Trump has turned out to be a conservative. So, by the way, most conservative surprise. What are you going to do? It's great. It's a great surprise for many of us. I'll give you an example of what we have entered, and this doesn't bother anybody. It doesn't bother anybody on the left. It doesn't bother liberals, whom it should bother. The problem with liberals is not that they're liberal, is that they're wimps. With the exception of a handful like Alan Dershowitz, who readily acknowledges that as a liberal and a Jew, his enemy is the left, not the right. Those are his words, not mine. They are mine, too, but they are his. So are you familiar with Mark Duplass? Is he? You're not. Okay. I don't know Hollywood, so I don't know who's famous and who's not. But he's famous enough to have subject of a story yesterday. Mark Duplass apologizes for a disaster tweet praising Ben Shapiro. This is from Variety. Actor and filmmaker Mark Duplass, D-U-P-L-A-S-S, has apologized for initially praising the right-wing pundit and Daily Wire founder Ben Shapiro on Twitter. By the way, has Variety ever described anyone as left-wing? I ask that question because I want you to understand the way in which news is reported to you. But it is all written by people on the left, and therefore they don't think it is necessary to ever identify anyone as left. Do you know that it has never happened that I have been described in mainstream media as anything but conservative, talk show host Dennis Prager, conservative. But they never tell you liberal or leftist, never. They even cite the Southern Poverty Law Center and don't say left-wing. Now, you can't get left of the Southern Poverty Law Center. It's a left-wing hate group, and it's used by the mainstream media to find whom to attack as haters. It's part of the madness that has overtaken our society among the very well-educated. Let me continue the Variety article here. Actor and filmmaker Mark Duplass has apologized. Apologized, get it? For initially praising the right-wing pundit and Daily Wire founder Ben Shapiro on Twitter and encouraging his followers to consider following Shapiro, stating that the tweet was a disaster on many levels. I'm really sorry. See, I told you, you should read my column. I wish you'd read my column every Tuesday. A few weeks ago, I wrote that the greatest fear in America is fear of the left. This is a perfect example. They run a sort of mafia intimidation racket, the left. I'm really sorry, Duplass tweeted Thursday morning. That's yesterday. I now understand. I love this. I now understand. He's been shown the light. He's been re-educated. I now understand that I need to be more diligent and careful. I'm working on that. I want to be clear that I in no way endorse hatred, racism, homophobia, xenophobia, or any such form of intolerance.
The racist, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, Islamophobic, you name it.
Does Ben Shapiro endorse hatred, racism, homophobia, xenophobia, or any such form of intolerance? Duplass said the tweet was meant to encourage unity, but admitted, quote, sometimes I move too quickly when I get excited or fail to do enough research. What research did he come up with to teach him that he should not have liberals read a conservative named Shapiro? Frightening. It's frightening stuff that's happening. Every day I bring you more examples. I think every day that nothing can be worse than the day before, calling the supporters of Donald Trump Nazis.
If you vote for Trump, then you, the voter, you, not Donald Trump, are standing at the border like Nazis going, you here, you here. And I think we now have to flip it. And it's a given, the evilness of Donald Trump.
If you hold down the woman while the rapist is raping her, and you didn't rape her, are you a rapist?
Tens of millions of people voted for him after he showed his cards for years.
But are you suggesting that they're racist? The people who vote, all the people who voted for Donald Trump are racist.
Yes.
Yeah. If Republicans weren't so racist, they could encourage black people who are morally conservative to be on their side.
Those people who are supporting what he's doing here are racist, period.
It's just movements and people that are speaking up for things, whether we're talking about civil rights movement, whatever else, those movements should be nonviolent, but they should not be non-confrontational.
And so these policies that this administration is putting forth are intentionally cruel, they are racist, and it is our job as citizens to speak out against that. Now, does that mean that we're going to be violent? No. But does that mean that Sarah Sanders can have a nice, quiet dinner with her family when she's taking our tax dollars to implement this policy? I don't think so.
Anybody who votes for and supports a racist is a racist. You are culpable, white America. I'm sorry.
Is it complicit or either you're enabling?
But you guys were involved with Being Patriotic, right?
Very, very patriotic, but not...
Being Patriotic was the group that contacted and helped organize some of these activities that you posted on your own Facebook account.
Those were legitimate.
Those were Russians.
They were not Russians. I don't go with the Russians.
Find out very clearly what his interests are.
President Walker, how do you resist the temptation to run up and wring her neck?
Why 25% of the country, whether it's 25, 20, 30%, are hardcore racist. They do not want to see brown people coming into America. That's just what's going on here. I mean,
of certain individuals and institutions, we will, as per Chief Jim Hopper, punch some people in the face when they seek to destroy the meek and the disenfranchised and the marginalized. And we will do it all with soul, with heart, and with joy.
There are still generations of people, older people, who were born and bred and marinated in it, in that prejudice and racism, and they just have to die.
A lot of his supporters believe that we are the enemy of the American people, and that is really, really an awful situation. We are not the enemy of the American people. We love the American people.
Nothing happens. That was on Joe Scarborough's show, and he listens in silent agreement as a guy, Donnie, what's his name? Deutsch says that all the followers, that's because I'm thinking of the word Nazi. All of the supporters of Donald Trump are Nazis, his fellow American citizens. So, of course, what a young person hearing that thinks is, hey, what's so bad about a Nazi? My neighbor supports Trump. He's a Nazi. So I guess they weren't that bad. This is a very important article, so I'm reading to you from Variety. An actor and a filmmaker, Mark Duplass. This is what he said in his tweet. All right? Fellow liberal, if you are interested at all in crossing the aisle, you should consider following at Ben Shapiro. I don't agree with him on much, but he's a genuine person who once helped me for no other reason than to be nice. He doesn't bend the truth. His intentions are good. The tweet has since been deleted. Now, let me ask you a question so you will understand how despicable the left is as compared to the right. Let us say I am on the right, and I'm better known than Mark Duplass. Let us say that I tweeted out, folks, it's very important for you to read liberals, so I suggest that you read the following person, whom I don't agree with, but it's very important to read what others have to say. And then I filled in some name of a Washington Post columnist or a New York Times columnist. All right, let's just say I did that. Would I be hated by conservatives for doing that? Or would there be one giant, so what? That's fine. We all read liberals and leftists. Prager's right. Conservatives should read people on the left. Do you understand every day I bring to you how despicable the left is? Putin, is the great threat to Western civilization. I don't know why you're not convinced. I have theories as to why you're not convinced. And it's too painful. It's like the God that failed. Once you realize what a fraud, moral fraud, leftism is, you can be left empty in terms of belief. Read the God that failed. People who believed in communism until Stalin made a pact with Hitler. By the way, a lot of people still believed in communism. They just changed their views of Hitler. The God that failed. But for Arthur Kessler and the others who wrote in that book, when did it come out? It came out in the 1940s. It's a very important book. And that's what every one of you should be writing. My leftist God failed. This is an example. Is there any mirror image on the right of a man saying on the right, hey, you know what? I think you should read the following or follow the tweets of the following guys on the left. I don't agree with them, but it's good to be aware of what they say. Would we bombard this man with hate? No, but on the left, they're right. By the way, the left is right. Why does the left make this guy delete his tweet and publicly recant that a liberal should read a conservative? Because they know deep down, if you read us, you'll change your mind. That's why. Because the left is an empty intellectual nothing. It's hollow. It is all hollow. It's a very strong artillery defending nothing. There is nothing there. Nothing. They are afraid of our ideas. Not afraid of our violence. I fear left-wing violence. They are afraid of our ideas. This is proof. I bring you the proof. Does it change everybody's mind? No, it doesn't. Because you don't want the God to fail, your God to fail. Duplass said in his Thursday statement that he does not endorse any form of intolerance, but he still believes in bipartisan understanding and will continue to promote peace and decency. Duplass Duplass concluded the statement by thanking those who reached out to him with constructive criticism about the tweet. This is perfect. This is what happened under Mao. Not only do you have to recant, you have to thank the people who just crapped on you. It's perfect. It's perfect leftism. It's a very important thing that you remember how much they fear that fellow leftists hear us. We have no such fear. None. That they, and they're right. That is the one of the few things I agree with the left. Do not let your followers listen to any of us, especially the intellectual right. Do not allow them to read us, to listen to us. That's why PragerU is so effective. That's a good point. Yes. He just put up a sign having me read that. He's right. It doesn't take a long time. You know what? For people to understand that conservatism is common sense. Conservatism is decency and common sense. That's all it is. It's incredibly simple. Be self-reliant. Do as much good as you can for your fellow human being. Do not rely on the state to do that. Tell the truth and fight evil. Real evil, not make-believe evils. That's why we're so effective. Be interesting. I was called by someone writing for the New York Times, doing an extensive piece on Prager University. Why is it changing young people into conservatives? The real answer is it would change any adult into a conservative who listened with an open mind. It doesn't take much. When I heard Ronald Reagan say government is the problem, not the solution, what was these exact words? What, remember the exact words of Ronald Reagan?
Government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem.
Government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem. Yes, that's exactly right. You know, here's a little point on that is worth remembering the next time you speak to a college-educated person who probably doesn't think clearly. They'll tell you all the evil done in the name of religion in history, and there has been a lot of evil done in the name of religion. I couldn't agree more. Ask them, however, what century was the most mass murder in the history of the world? And of course, it was the 20th century. There's no close second. Okay. So ask them who did that. And the answer, aside from everything else, is big government. Nobody ever thinks, wait a minute, can government ever get too big? Does it become dangerous as it becomes bigger and bigger? Without the big state, you couldn't have had Nazism and communism. Okay? Just so you'll know. There's just so much evil that individuals can do. West Hollywood, California, and Katie. Hello, Katie. Dennis Prager.
Hey, Dana. Good to talk to you. Just on this topic, so cuckoo. I was having dinner with a friend. I respect him so much. He's so incredibly brilliant, but he's blinded by liberalism. And I mentioned to him, I can't even remember the topic, but it was an opinion different than his. And he questioned me. And I just said, well, I listened to both sides. And he just flat out said, well, you shouldn't.
He's right. Oh. That proves he's brilliant. I'm not joking, because he's bright enough to understand that if you hear both sides, you'll turn conservative. Yes. No, that's the reason. We don't care if people hear. I don't know a single conservative who cares if people listen to liberal stuff or read liberal stuff or left-wing stuff. I've spent a whole lifetime. And I have never met such a human. He has every reason to fear that people hear us. That is correct. That's why people don't make the deals. I always advocate to those of you with relatives and friends on the left, tell them, I promise, I give you my word, I will listen for 2 weeks to anything you want me to listen to. NPR, any podcast of anybody on the left, whatever you want. And in turn, I would just ask you to listen for 2 weeks, and you It doesn't have to be Dennis Prager, but I'm obviously I'm talking on my behalf because I think I make these arguments intellectually. So just say use me as an example. If you don't want to use me, it doesn't matter. As I look, I just cited the guy who said use Ben Shapiro. It doesn't matter to me. But let them have 2 weeks. See what happens.